The Lord, everyone. Praise the Lord once again. And let us turn our Bibles to the book of Isaiah, chapter 58. Isaiah chapter 58. And we will read the first 9 verses together. Isaiah chapter 58, the 9 verses, first 9 verses, we will read alternatively, one after the other. Isaiah chapter 58. Cry aloud, spare not, lift up thy voice like a trumpet, and show my people their transgression, and the house of Jacob their sins.
If they seek me daily and delight to know my ways, as a nation that did righteousness and forsook not the ordinance of their God, they ask of me the ordinance of justice, they take delight in approaching God.
Wherefore have we fasted, say they, and thou seest not? Wherefore have we afflicted our soul, and thou takest no knowledge? Behold, in the day of your fast ye find pleasure, and exact all your labors.
Behold, you fast for strife and debate and strife with the fist of wickedness. You shall not fast as you do this day, to make your voice to be heard on high.
Is it such a fast that I have chosen, a day for a man to afflict his soul? Is it to bow down his head as a bulrush, and to spread sackcloth and ashes under him? Wilt thou call this a fast and an acceptable day to the Lord?
Is not this the fast that I have chosen, to loose the bands of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, and to let the oppressed go free, and that you break every yoke?
Verse 7. Is it not to deal thy bread to the hungry, and that thou bring the poor that are cast out to thy house? When thou seest the naked, that thou cover him, and that thou hide not thyself from thine own flesh.
Then shall your light break forth as a morning, and your health shall spring forth speedily, and your righteousness shall go before you, and the glory of the Lord shall be your real God.
Then shall thou call, verse 9, let us all read together. Then shall thou call, and the Lord shall answer. Thou shalt cry, and he shall say, Here I am. If thou take away from the midst of thee the yoke, and the putting forth of the finger, and speaking vanity. May the Lord bless the reading of these words, and our meditation of our hearts, and prepare us for the time of fasting. Our heavenly and gracious Almighty Father, we thank you for these words. Lord, the prophetic words of the prophet Isaiah regarding the children of Israel and children of Judah, Lord, regarding their fast. And this morning, Lord Father, as you have given us this portion also, speak to us. Holy Spirit, take control of my mouth, my words, my thoughts, and none of my thinking may prevail, but you speak, and we will all listen and yield to your leading this morning as we prepare to spend the next few hours in prayer. Help us, Father. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. 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 And once again, this is a very familiar portion for all of us, Isaiah 58. And many years ago, when we were still in the old church, old building, we used to gather for fasting and prayer at Uncle Thangvelu's house on Saturdays. I don't know how many of you remember that. On Saturdays, we used to gather at Uncle's house in the morning for fasting and prayer. And one of the brothers who had come from Kuwait, I forget his name. I don't know his name. But I remember the message that he gave very clearly from this chapter of Isaiah 58. This brother came from Kuwait. It's not a brother, Sister Salome's father, but some other brother who had come. And I was going through some difficult time debating regarding a matter which I had not known how to handle it. And the Lord spoke to me very clearly through this chapter of Isaiah 58. I remember very vividly. And so also I pray that the Lord will speak to all of us this morning also in a fresh way. If there are certain things that we need to set right in our lives before we fast and pray this morning and in the coming months. And it's a very important chapter with regards to fasting, and I want to spend some time in the later portion of this portion that we read, later verses, but I just want to read with you some verses from the beginning, just reading. Yeah, I'm not going to speak much. I just want to read with you so it will make sense to you what we are here up to. Verse 1, it says, "Cry aloud, spare not, lift up thy voice like a trumpet, and show my people their transgression, and the house of Jacob their sins. Yet they seek me daily, and delight to know my ways, as a nation that did righteousness, and forsook not the ordinance of their God. They ask of me the ordinance of justice. They take delight in approaching to God." You see, this verse 2, you can leave it there. Verse 2, it says, "You seek me daily." Children of Israel, you're seeking me daily, which we all do. We are asking the Lord, seeking him daily. We delight to know his ways. We want to know what the Lord wants to do. Lead us in this matter, that matter, our personal matter, our individual matter, our financial matters, our family matters, and all these things we delight to know. Lord, what is your will in this matter? As a nation that did righteousness, you see, you are as a nation, you Israel, you are actually trying to know what to do as a nation, and you want to do righteously. As a nation that is professing to do righteous, right things, and forsook not the ordinance of their God, and you have not forsaken whatever I have written through Moses, I have given to you from Moses, you have not forsaken them, you have kept them very carefully. They ask of me the ordinance of justice. They take delight in approaching to God, great delight in coming to the meetings, coming to the Word of God, coming to reading the Word of God daily, spending time in fasting. And you're doing all these things very religiously. You children of Israel, you're doing this, all these things. I don't have time to go one by one. Verse 3, and then you ask, "Wherefore have we fasted?" say they, "and thou seest not. Wherefore have we afflicted our soul? And thou takest no knowledge. Behold, in the day of your fast, ye find pleasure and exact all your labors." Look at that. We are questioning God. "Lord, have I not fasted for the last 20 years? Have I not fasted regularly for the last 30 years? Every first Saturday of the month, I have come and fasted. Many other days I have fasted. Are you not seeing all these things that I am doing? And why have we afflicted our body by fasting, by not eating? Don't you take knowledge of all these things?" But then the answers come. And then the answer come, "Behold, in the day of your fast, you find pleasure." Dear ones, this is where we need to pause and we need to ask ourselves, "Lord, am I taking pleasure? Am I finding any pain? Is there any pain in my fasting? Or is it just like Friday, yesterday? Or is it going to be just like tomorrow, Sunday, the Lord's Day? What is so different today?" You know, I'm speaking to myself, yeah? So it's not about you, but it's about me also. And so here is the Lord's answer. "You, in the day of your fasting, there is nothing different than yesterday and tomorrow. You woke up at the same time yesterday, you woke up this morning. You take pleasure in everything that you do. And you are, you know, this is talking especially about the people who were in Israel at that time. And they were making the workers work on these fast days. And they were making them work. And they were making them do hard labor on this day. And then it says, verse 4, "Behold, ye fast for strife and debate, and to smite with the fist of wickedness. Ye shall not fast as ye do this day, to make your voice to be heard on high." But the Lord says, yes, you are fasting. You are fasting to debate and to argue and to ask of me. But your hand of wickedness has not been moved. You want to continue on doing those wickedness. What is this wickedness that we do? You know, it's not about the children of Israel. It's about us now, right? The Lord is speaking to us. What is this wickedness that you and I are doing? Dear ones, whenever we are not obedient to the little promptings of the Holy Spirit, whenever we are not obedient to the leading of the Word of God in our life, whenever we are disobedient to the conscience that the Lord has kept alive in us, whenever we try to snuff that fire that is in us, whenever we try to ignore when the Lord is trying to speak to us, we are committing wickedness. We are committing wickedness against the Lord. You know, we may not be committing murder and adultery and all such other things that are listed. But when we disobey blatantly the Word of God, the promptings of God, the promptings of the Holy Spirit, the Spirit's leading in our life, when we say, go here, we go the other way. In Acts chapter 20, we don't have time to go there. Paul, when he goes to meet the elders at the church of Ephesus, he says, I am going hand bound by the Spirit of God to Jerusalem. I know the Spirit of God has bound me, and I'm being led as a slave by the Spirit of God to Jerusalem. And I know once I get there, I will have great affliction. You see, being bound by the Spirit of God, being bound by the Word of God, you know, do we tremor when we do the things against God's word? Do we fear when we do things against God's word? Does the Word of God speak to us? Do we allow the Word of God to work in us? Do we allow the Word of God to break us in many areas? Do we allow the Word of God to burn us in many areas in our life? Do we allow the Word of God to change us? Our thinking, our mindset, our talk, our vocabulary, our movements. When we don't do these things, it is pure wickedness that we are committing against the Lord himself. And then, verse 5, it says, is it such a fast that I have chosen, a day for a man to afflict his soul? Is it to bow down his head as a bulrush and to spread sackcloth and ashes under him? Will thou call this a fast and an acceptable day to the Lord? You see, the Lord is questioning all those outward things that you're doing to afflict your body, all those things that you're doing on the outside, but you're not willing to change on the inside. You're doing all these things. You're doing all these things. You know, we sang this beautiful song, that just now, I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Have you gained any new height in the last week, last 11 months? Any new height? Have you stepped into a new realm of your relationship with the Lord? Still praying as I am onward bound, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. So I ask me, what new height have you gained? Yeah. What new steps have you taken? Where have you changed in your life? I want to live above the world, though Satan's darts at me are hurled. Yes, for faith, I want to scale the utmost height and catch a gleam of glory bright. Yes, dear friends, dear family, you know, let us ask ourselves. Let us not deceive ourselves. When we are at the same level, we have not moved one inch, this song means nothing to us. You know, it's a very beautiful rendition. And this chapter also is exactly the same thing. It is telling us, it is asking us as believers to step into something new, step into something different, step into something little more painful, step a little higher. You know, when you climb higher and higher on a mountain, you know what happens? The breathing becomes more difficult. The height becomes more difficult to scale. It is not easy like you were at the bottom of the hill. Now the oxygen level has reduced. The air is more heavier. The weather has changed. It has become more colder. The strength has waned. We don't have strength to carry on till the next few heights. It becomes more difficult. And now the Lord is asking us, stop staying at the foothills. Climb a little higher. And as you're climbing, if there is no pain in your climbing, it means you are just circling the mountain at the bottom of the hill. You're just circling around the bottom of the hill. And if there is no pain, if there is no sacrifice, if there is no suffering in your fasting, in your prayers, if there is no wailing, if there is no laboring, nothing is going to happen. You're just going to go round and round. Yeah, because of lack of time. And it says, I just want to move forward. And I just want to go to the next verse. Verse 7. It says, is it not to deal thy bread to the hungry, and that thou bring the poor that are cast out of thy house? When thou seest the naked, that thou cover him, and that thou hide not thyself from thine own flesh. Here, there are a few things the prophet is telling prophetically to the children of Israel, to us, to give your bread to the hungry. Number one, to give. You know, it's very difficult to give. It's easy to keep. It's difficult to give. And whenever we give, you know, our hands are still tight-fisted when we give. And so the first thing the Lord is asking us this morning is to give, 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 give. Yes, the initial giving may be painful giving. It may not be wholeheartedly. Yeah. And Paul also writing, he says in the same chapter of Acts 20, he says, giving is better than receiving. And he lists all the things that he did. Give to the church at Ephesus for 3.5 long years. And he lists all of them. And he does, when we don't have time to read that in Acts chapter 20. Just giving, it is painful. Give your bread to the hungry, number one. Yeah, don't give your bread to those who are full. You know what happens when you give your bread to those who are full? Their hunger is not satisfied. You don't satisfy their hunger. When you give to the hungry, his hunger is satisfied. Do something that will bring satisfaction to others. Number two, to take the poor and needy back to your house. One is to give, and the next is to take. What are you taking? Take the ones, those who are poor and needy, into your homes. Yeah, forgive me for sharing this example, but you know, it's a personal example of my mother-in-law, and she has many failings in her life, but one of the great things that she does is whenever there is a beggar that walks through the front of the house, she would call them, and she would make them sit in the porch. And she would feed them. It's easy to just give few rupees and send them away, but she would bring them in. She would call them and she would feed them. And it is difficult. It is difficult. Yeah, it takes time. You have to watch. You have to make. You have to keep company. And to feed, to give, to take the poor and needy back into your house. And then it says to cover the naked. And to cover the naked. You know, we were going through the book of Corinthians in our Bible study. And 1 Corinthians chapter 13 talks about love. And two other places it says, love covers all sins. Yeah. And here we see verse 7, to cover the naked. How do we cover the naked? We cover the naked with our love. We cover the naked with our love. Don't expose the nakedness of others. Don't expose the weaknesses of others. Don't expose their shame. You remember one of the sons of Noah did not cover the shame of his father, and he was cursed. He was cursed. Let us be people who can cover the weakness, the weak spots of other people. And then it says, do not hide yourself from yourself. Verse 7, it says, do not hide. Don't hide yourself. Don't go run and hide yourself and say, oh no, I cannot do this. Don't hide from yourself. Dear ones, when we do these things, when we are obedient to these things in verse 7, and then verse 8 will happen to all of us. Let us read verse 8 together, and I will end there. Verse 8, it says, then shall thy light break forth as the morning, and then health shall spring forth speedily, and thy righteousness shall go before thee. The glory of the Lord shall be thy rear reward. Then shall thou call, and the Lord shall answer. Thou shall cry, and he shall say, here I am. You see, this is what the Lord is going to do. If you can do verse 7, the Lord says, then my light, in verse 8, it says, then my light will break forth as the morning. You know, as the sunlight comes out of the darkness that is enveloping the earth, all earth, as the sun breaks out in the morning, then he says, I will come suddenly. My sun is waiting. It's just not breaking forth because of so much darkness. Then when you do verse 7, my light will come. It will break forth. It will come through. And your health shall spring forth speedily. Yes, many of us, the Lord is speaking to us. Those of us who are in poor health, the Lord says, he's very lovingly speaking, you know, your health will come up quickly. You underline the word speedily. There it says, and before it says, and I shall break forth and I shall spring forth. Yes, all these things the Lord is not going to hold back. It is automatic. It is automatic. It has to happen. When you do verse 7, he says, I will break forth. I will spring forth. And verse 8, if you can please put back verse 8 there one more time. And thy righteousness shall go before thee. What happens? The righteousness, my light, his righteousness will go before us. And we will know where to go, how to go. You know, the light, the path will be lit before us to walk in it. And then what happens? The glory of the Lord shall be thy rear guard. It will protect you from the back. Nobody can touch you. You remember the children of Israel when they were at the edge of the Red Sea, and when there were mountains and the wilderness on both sides, no place to run, the Red Sea in the front and Pharaoh in the back. You know what happened? The glory of the Lord covered them from the back. They could not, the Pharaoh and his chariots, they could not come through because the glory of the Lord covered the children of Israel from the back. So the enemy could not come through. They were protected, and until they passed through the Red Sea, and then the glory of the Lord disappeared. Dear ones, the Lord is telling us this morning, if you do that in verse 9, just the beginning portion of verse 9, then thou shalt call and the Lord shall answer. Thou shalt cry and he shall say, here I am. Wonderful. Then the Lord is giving us this free invitation, this free invitation to us, calling us. Yes, then you can call me. You can call me and I will answer. You can cry and I will hear. I am here and I will come speedily. Dear friends, dear family, you know, this is all I have to say this morning. You know, many times we keep asking, Lord, I've been praying, I've been waiting, and let us go into a next level of our relationship and our fasting. And Lord, examining ourselves, Lord, is there anything in my own life, Lord, this morning that I need to examine, that I need to change. Show me that I may not just circle around the mountain, but I want to scale little more higher ground. I want to press on to little more. So my question to you is, what is that new thing that you have done this morning to press on, to press on, to press on? May the Lord help us this morning. May the Spirit of the Lord, you know, you are my family, and I'm one among you. And so I shared this with great burden. Yes, as brother was praying at the beginning, that the uncle was praying at the beginning, that the Holy Spirit may give us the utterance to pray. And I feel that many times our prayers are just prayers of out of knowledge. We are not seeking what the Holy Spirit wants us to pray. We are praying out of our knowledge, our understanding of our circumstances. We are praying for the things that we know in our mind. But He wants us to go a little more higher. Lord, is it just 5% of my prayer that is in the Spirit and 95% that is in the knowledge? But Paul exhorting in the book of Corinthians, he says, I pray in the Spirit, I can pray in the knowledge, but it is better to pray in the Spirit. As uncle was praying, yes, we need to ask the Lord, Lord, teach me to pray in the Spirit, because the Spirit knoweth the deep things of the Lord. If the Spirit knoweth the deep things that are in your heart, I may not know. In the past many years, yes, I have gotten few phone calls, some phone calls, not many, some phone calls of how the Spirit has led in the prayer time. Yeah, I wish all of us, everyone would pray in the Spirit, because then we will be able to scale the mountain to a next level, to go to the next level in our climbing up this mountain. May the Lord help us this morning that we may all scale to the next level in our climbing.